Ever since the turn of the century, when the Block Brothers Tobacco Company decided to use the sides of barns to advertise their product, mail pouch tobacco signs have been a part of the landscape of rural America. In 1974, Congress decided they were so special that it declared them national landmarks. The signs are as simple as a shaker chair, big block letters set against a black background with a blue border, the word chew painted white, mail pouch tobacco a bold canary yellow. If the barn is big enough, another line is added. It says simply, treat yourself to the best, and is painted white. A lot of the barns have one added feature. Down in the right-hand corner are the letters HW. They stand for Harley Warrick, the last of the mail pouch tobacco sign painters.
Well, first 10,000 is a little rough, and then after that you get the hang of it.
Harley Warrick has traveled thousands of miles over the last 42 years. He figures he's painted about 20,000 barns in at least 30 states. Driving with him on the way to a job in Belmont County, Ohio, is like driving through a museum of mail pouch tobacco signs. Belmont County in eastern Ohio is where Harley Warrick lives. It has more mail pouch tobacco signs than any other county in America, and Harley remembers all of them. As he wends his way over the hilly, winding roads of his home county, Harley is constantly on the lookout for a good barn to paint.
The ideal one is in a curve in a road where you have to look at it. You know, you're looking straight into that turn, and you can't miss it. In other words, even after night, the lights will shine on it. There used to be one on that barn right there.
This red one?
Mm-hmm. You can still see the traces of tobacco on there.
They just painted over it, huh?
Yeah, that was back years ago, you know, and the guy bought it and he didn't want it on there, so he just painted it off. Now that they've got little, popularity, he wants it back. But...
And you don't want to put it back up?
Oh, no, put it back.
He took it off and that's it, huh?
I'll stick with those guys that stuck with it all these years, you know.
There's a good barn.
Mm-hmm. You wouldn't see it quite long enough, though.
You wouldn't see it?
You have to keep your eye on that turn, so.
That's true. If it's too windy, it's not good then,
yeah.
Huh?
Well, we're getting close now. There's a little bird. One store and two beer joints. That's about it.
What's the name of this town?
Malagut.
Malagut? A few miles outside Malagut, Ohio, is the barn that Harley will paint that day. It lies in the middle of a pasture, behind an electric fence, and through a herd of cows. To the untrained eye, this barn looks as though it's about to collapse, but Harley says it can stand for another 100 years. One side of it already has a mail pouch sign. Another has just been reconstructed, a perfect wall for Harley to paint. He begins mixing his colors with pure gasoline. Harley says that makes the paint dry faster. Once the paint is ready, he puts the scaffolding in place against the side of the barn. Now Harley steps back and lights his pipe. Sometimes he chews tobacco, but mostly he smokes it. He puts his hands in the pockets of his overalls and surveys the wall, which he is about to claim as his own. Now let me ask you something. You got a blank barn right here, right now.
Mm-hmm.
Where do you begin?
Center.
Center.
Find your center and then go each way.
Find the center. Good advice for many things. When it comes to barns, you count the rafters.
18, 20, 22, 24, 26.
Divide them in half, and that's the center.
The E and Q will just be a little bit to the right of that center line. And then the up and down bar of the P will set right on the center. The A in tobacco is on the center. And this one I won't put treat yourself the best on it anyway, because it would be down behind these bushes. You wouldn't read it anyway. So.
Makes sense.
You know you're painting something you can't see.
That's right.
That's the idea of a sign. It's to inform, but... Some of these modern signs you see anymore, you have trouble reading them. You know, all the curlicues on them. And
This is just a straight-ahead sign.
This sign, it gives you the whole message in less than 10 words. It's like a telegram. Hey, chew, male flies, treat yourself the best. You let less than 10 words in the whole sign.
Harley begins painting. Quickly, the letters C-H-E-W appear in white against the wooden barn. At first, the letters look rough, unfinished, until Harley outlines them neatly in black and then fills in the rest of the background with black also. Harley moves on to the next line. All right, now we're down at the next level. What letters are you about to do now?
Mail patch.
These letters will be bigger. Harley draws two lines to measure their height. Working in yellow now, he begins blocking out the two words. He works in freehand and bristles at the mention of a stencil.
That's a dirty word, a sign painter. Stencil. It's like putting training wheels on a motorcycle.
It's an insult, huh?
I said, you do that freehand? And I said, well, I tried it with my feet, and that didn't work too good.
And there goes the P. Do you ever get bored doing it?
Oh, some days, yeah. I get up the next day, there's nothing else I want to do.
Do you have favorites?
Pardon?
Do you have favorites? Favorite barns? Barns?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, you got not so much the barn, it's the people that own it. You get to know the people pretty well that owns the barns. And I've got one where I'm leasing the barn off of the grandson of the original guy that I leased it off of.
Oh, that's
and
then, nice.
No matter what time you get there, you have to go in and have something to eat. I don't care if it's the middle of the morning and they put a banquet on the table and get out the scrapbook and show you all the new additions to the family since you were there last time. Just like, you know, like going home.
I'm never going to think of the same about these male pouch tobacco signs again.
Yeah, they get in your blood.
How many more do you think you're going to be able to paint in your lifetime?
I don't know. This might be my last one. Heck, I never know. I don't intend to quit. As long as I feel like doing it.
It takes Harley Warrick about 4 hours to paint one of his barns. He works all alone these days. None of the young kids he's hired from time to time have stayed with the job. So when he retires, if he ever does, it may be the end of the mail pouch tobacco signs. These days, a lot of people think it's not a great idea to advertise the stuff anyway, and probably it isn't. But that's for other men to decide. For Harley Warrick, painting signs on the sides of barns has been a good way to earn a living. And if people want to think of it as some kind of art, well, that's their business. Whatever you call it, Harley Warrick just likes to paint.
You're liable to run into Harley any place around Ohio, West Virginia, parts of Maryland, or out in the Pennsylvania coal country. But even if you don't actually run across him, you're sure to run across traces of him. Harley Warrick is the last man in America whose job is painting male pouch chewing tobacco ads on barns. For 80 years, men did that all over the country, but now there's only Harley. The Federal Highway Beautification Act prohibits billboards on interstate highways, but Congress made an exception in Harley's case, saying those mail pouch signs are national landmarks. Harley works alone, and it looks like heavy work. It takes him about 30 minutes to set up his scaffolding rig, and then he climbs up there and goes at it, without laying out the letters or drawing any straight lines. It takes from 4 to 5 hours to finish a sign, depending on how big the barn is. In the old days, farmers had to be paid by the mail pouch folks for these signs. Nowadays, most people are delighted to have Harley slap a sign up there for nothing. Harley got started painting barns when a crew painted his parents' barn right after he got back from the war in 1945. He's 57 now, and he's been at it ever since.
I noticed when you start out with putting up the chew, you just slap that E in there first.
Get the left
well, you start in your center and work each way, and then if you got your spacing right, it has to come out right. So,
but you didn't even seem to put any marks up there.
I never marked anything. First 1,000, you had to mark them out, but after that, it got easy. So.
First 1,000?
Yeah, I've done about 17,000 of them, so it gets a little easier.
50, 75 years ago, practically every adult male in the country chewed, I guess, didn't it?
Oh, yeah. I know where I went to grade school, when you was only 8, 10 years old, you either chewed or somebody stuck it down your throat, so you learned pretty young.
You know, what's the trick to learning to chew tobacco? Every time I tried it, I swallowed the juice.
Well, you got to, you know, just don't try to put too much in your mouth at one time. Just a small pinch to start with, just about like that.
Yeah.
Until you get used to it, and then don't think about having tobacco in your mouth, or just pretend it's chewing gum or something, and don't swallow it until you get, you know, broke in on it.
That kind of separates the man from the boys, doesn't it?
Well, not necessarily. There's probably a lot of ladies chew it too.
Now that I never heard of.
Well, yeah, my grandmother chewed, so.
Really?
Yeah.
Harley also paints mail pouch signs on birdhouses and bird feeders, which he makes himself, and even on his mailbox. In fact, you get the idea, Harley will paint mail pouch signs on any flat surface. He does some landscape painting, and guess what the subjects are in those? The last we saw of Harley, he was touching up an old sign on a barn in a state park. When Harley's gone, there won't be any more new mail pouch signs, and it may not be easy to find somebody to keep the old ones up. It takes a master's touch. Anybody can see that. It may seem rather odd that an advertisement for chewing tobacco is sort of wound up as part of our national heritage, like the Thanksgiving turkey and the bald eagle, but it was probably inevitable. In this television age, it sometimes seems as though life is just one long commercial for something or other. And after all, it could have been a lot worse. It could have been an ad for Preparation H. Hughes Rudd, ABC News, near Barnesville, Ohio.
Oh, I don't believe he did it. Oh.
I've been at about 17,000 of these mail pouch barns in my time. I've been chewing mail pouch for as long as I've painted these old barns. That's 35 years, you know. I like its real tobacco flavor. It lasts longer, too. Nothing fancy, mind you, just a good, moist chew. Why am I still painting? Well, I guess I'm a little like the mail pouch folks. When you got a good thing, you stick with it. The older generation, anyway, they remember when they was kids, they would go to grandma's house or wherever they was going, and they would count the mail pouch signs in between, or the like the Bermichet signs, and it got to be a tradition. So I just like to keep that up.
In the early morning, as the rest of us are preparing for another day, Harley Warrick is already at work, adding another national landmark to the American countryside. He's the last of a vanishing breed, the sole remaining mail pouch barn painter. 37 years ago, when Harley first started, he covered a 10-state area, painting about 700 barns a year. But in 1966, a Highway Beautification Act passed, banning commercial signs near main highways. The painting all but stopped. Then in 1974, Congress had a change of heart, declaring there are some types of outdoor advertising of a unique character that justify preservation. The mail pouch barns have become national landmarks, And with them, Harley Warrick had become an institution.
That's what they tell me. I don't notice any difference. I still go out here and work the same as I did 37 years ago. I think you're talking about somebody else.
Harley never planned on being a sign painter. In fact, his career with Mail Pouch started by accident.
I didn't pick it. In fact, I wasn't even looking for a job. I just come home from World War II, and I just got off the boat and been home 2 days. We had one on our barn there at home, and crew came along to paint it. I went across and was talking to them, and they needed a helper, so I went back across the road and got my suitcase and took off. So, been there ever since.
Today, while he still paints new barns, Harley spends a large part of his time maintaining the old ones. He estimates he's painted and repainted about 17,000 barns in his time. Oh, and don't let his modesty fool you into thinking he's got an easy job. He paints the perfectly straight, multi-sized letters 30 feet in the air, standing on a roof or ladder, freehand.
You've got to train your eye for it so that you can tell where the letters go. You can see the sign on there before you ever start, see, where everything goes. First 5,000 you have to measure, but after that, it becomes pretty easy.
And although the times are few and far between, Harley has been known to make a few mistakes.
A lot of them I do intentionally. Misspelling catch the motor's attention. And you put either three C's in tobacco or put the words chew, you put chaw, or P-O-O-C-H, make it pooch. Then somebody will write in, their little granddaughter caught that mistake. So the company will send the letter on to me, then I send them a little board with the mail pouch on it correctly, tell them thank you for paying attention to our signs. So, then usually I just leave them that way. I don't change them.
Harley has a simple, uncomplicated view of life, one that many caught up in today's fast pace might envy. And he's got his own formula for happiness.
Yeah, I'd get a job that you would do for nothing, and then get somebody to pay you to do it. And that's always been my advice, if you can possibly do it. Because I do a lot of the work I don't get paid for, I do just for the thought of it. Then when you die, you're not going to take anything with you anyway. So you're working your whole life for nothing anyhow. So enjoy what you're doing while you're here.
While Harley is making better than the $32 a week he earned 30 years ago, he works as a contractor to the General Cigar Company. This means he receives no fringe benefits nor retirement fund. So Harley started making his own fringe benefits, but quite by accident. A few years ago, he built some bird feeders to give to his friends as Christmas gifts. When people saw them, it wasn't long before Harley had more orders than he could handle. And of course, the bird feeders bear the Mail Pouch slogan. General Cigar Company has no plans to replace Harley when he stops painting. This makes his work a unique slice of Americana, a fact that makes Harley proud. In fact, Harley puts his signature on all of his work. As for just how long Harley plans to keep painting.
Well, some of them asked me what I was going to do when I got to 65, and I said, I'll just slow down a little bit so my helper can keep up with me.
So for now, Harley Warrick will continue to bestow his own special legacy on rural America, painting barns as old and as strong as the mail pouch tradition.
At least you're doing something to show you've been around anyway. Maybe you can make $1 million and die tomorrow, and the only thing anybody remember you by is people fighting over your money. This way, at least you've got something out there to show you've been there anyway. Somebody to pay you to do it. And that's always been my advice, if you can possibly do it, because I do a lot of the work I don't get paid for, I do just for the thought of it. So, then when you die, you're not going to take anything with you anyway. So you're working your whole life for nothing anyhow. So enjoy what you're doing while you're here.
Yesterday would have been a nice day. All the rules of painting, you break them on painting these barns. Jeez, use that for a while.
I'll tell you the truth, I'd rather start with this old rough barn than one that's already painted.
Test.
Like the old widow, you know, I think every one I do, I think it's going to be my last one, so I put everything I got into it, see. Well, I retired 3 years ago. It's just my vacation. Makes it nice. You don't have to be in a hurry. We had one on our barn at home. Right on the button. And, when you go out to do the milking, you'd look up there at that thing and you say, well, somebody paints those things, you know? So then I went to service and come back about 4 years later. Just happened that I was home about 2 days and they come through to repaint the sign. And I went over and was talking to them and they said, well, we need a guy on the other one of the crew. So I went over and got my duffel bag and took off with him. That's the way I started. Yeah, the last 20 years I worked by myself.
I never seen you paint a barn, so I got my first chance in my life to see the guy at work. Yeah, he's very good. I heard a lot about him, been reading about him. And talk to the man, and find out really what he is. He knows what he's doing.
Oh, it's absolutely a piece of America that's gone away. I mean, there's so few of them left that are of good quality. They're fading, the barns are falling down, they're burning down. And to see it done, I've been photographing them for a number of years, and this is the one part of it I've never seen is actually, you know, the painting of it. And it was, it's worth a day of vacation today to come out here and watch him do it.
Well, you remember when you was there and what happened and, you know, just what was going on at that time. And you remember the people that owned the barn and their families and whatever. Yeah, I can remember I'll be driving along a piece of highway and it's just something tells you now I've been here before. And then you look and the barn's not there anymore, but that's where the barn used to be. Oh, 21,000 something. I don't know. I don't keep track of them. Guy would probably up and quit if he knew how many he'd done. At one time there was four crews. It was two guys on each crew. And then there, I forget which year it was, they passed the billboard ball. To the Highway Beautification Act. So then the company thought, well, we was gonna have to stop painting them, so they laid us all off. And then it went on for a couple years there, and another senator, he got them declared national landmarks, an act of Congress. So they sent me back out by myself just to do a few to see how this was gonna turn out, and then it just stayed that way from there on. Getting there, getting close. Any way you go about it, this sign always ends up on a T. Whether you start from this end or start from that end, done to a T, that's the way it is.
That's the best thing I ever seen. I waited a few years to see him, watch him paint the barn here. I got it done today. Yeah.
Now that is my initials, Harley Warrick.
See them along the back roads of America, those quaint picture postcard buildings known as mail pouch barns. So called for the distinctive chewing tobacco ads painted across them, They are vanishing remnants of America's past. In 1879, the Block Brothers of Wheeling, West Virginia, introduced a shredded, licorice-flavored tobacco chew called Mail Pouch, named after the mailbags that steamboats threw onto the riverbanks. But the brothers' true genius was in using thousands of barns throughout rural America to put the name of their product on the tongue of every traveler to come down the pike.
Anybody who drives by on the road and they see that and they think, oh, there's the Mail Pouch barn, and it might remind them of another time. It reminds me a lot of my grandpa, and he's a very honorable person, and it kind of exemplifies like what the days of yesteryear were, you know, when it was a better time.
Ohio school teacher Eddie Roberts has a passion for these barns. Every chance she gets, she's on the road with her camera. Her husband Tim waits behind the wheel.
Although he doesn't share my enthusiasm, he's still an honorable chauffeur, and he drives and waits patiently in the car while I take the picture. I've been taking pictures of mail pouch barns for about 8 or 9 years now, and I would say probably I photographed in the neighborhood of 300 to 400 barns.
Every so often, a barn owner will come out to chew the fat with Eddie. Dale Leach of Sparta, Pennsylvania, has two 104-year-old barns, bookended with mail pouch signs. He still gets paid by the company.
Yeah, they send me a check once a year, $10 a year advertising fee.
The previous owner of these barns didn't like the ads at all.
And I'm not sure exactly what religion it was, but the tobacco thing was against their religion, so they painted it over for that reason. What I like about it, you get crazy people all the time stopping, taking pictures, wanting to know a little bit about it. Just the nostalgia part of it, the history of it, it's like a piece of Americana. Don't want to get rid of it.
The black and yellow signs with blue edging were by far the most common style, followed by the fancier red barns. But Eddie likes the ghost barns. Faded beauties painted over with subsequent ads. Only the faintest hint of the original mail pouch ad haunts the weathered boards. Two sides of the same barn show what time and the elements can do. Every year, nature eats away a little more of these treasures. The rain and sun curl another plank. The vines peel off a little paint. The wind blows away some more color. And since the last of the great mail pouch painters, Harley Warrick, passed away in November of 2000, there's no one to carry on the tradition of painting or repainting these signs. A young man named Mark Turley lasted only a year in the business. Harley Warrick painted over 20,000 barns in his career. In 1996, he was filmed painting a wall in the Wheeling, West Virginia Artisans Center. Eddie got to meet this legend.
Boy, he was something else, quite a character, and so dry. Like, he would make a joke and I wouldn't know if it was funny, and so I'd wait to see if he would laugh or not.
But just for the heck of it, every once in a while, I'll put 3 C's in tobacco, just to get somebody to pay attention to it. And sure enough, they'll write into the company and say that sign painter must have been drunk or something. He's got 3 C's in there. So they send him a letter, you know, thanking him for paying attention to the sign.
I'm sure he has plenty more stories. I'm really sorry that he passed away before we got to hear more of them.
With Harley Warrick gone and no one to replace him, Eddie Roberts fears a day will come when all these barns have faded away. And so she'll keep traveling the back roads of America.
Okay, let's all go right. Find another one.
Seeking her beloved barns, taking her pictures. Capturing history so that future generations can have a taste of the country's colorful past.
An old mail pouch, tobacco sign, fading on the barn.
These are the names of America's past: Union workman, red man, Yankee girl, but they're names of the present too: Red Horse, Happy Jim, Big Kick, If you haven't seen these packages on your shelves, it's because you haven't visited any good country stores lately, like Hartman's Grocery here in St. Clairsville, Ohio. Red Coon, Rosebud, Bull of the Woods, Days of Work, Brown's Mule, Black Mariah. 360 million packages were sold last year, which is an awful lot of chewing tobacco. And mail pouch. It was the mail pouch barns that got us started thinking about chewing tobacco in the first place. You've seen them if you've been down any country road in the Middle West, standing on a hilltop or a curve, inviting the passerby to chew mail pouch. In Ohio, we came across Harley Warrick renewing that ancient black and gold message and learned from him that he has painted this same injunction in just this same way on 600 barns a year for 22 years, and that there were mail pouch barns for 70 years before he even started. Chew mail pouch. We wondered if anybody still does. So we followed the trail of barns to the Granddaddy Mail Pouch sign, the one on the side of the factory across the Ohio River in Wheeling, West Virginia. And there, a young Princeton man with a chaw in his jaw, Stuart Block, the chewing tobacco heir, set us straight. Chewing tobacco can't be as big a thing today as it was 50 or 60 years ago, can it?
No, it certainly isn't. Chewing tobacco has been on a very gentle decline of the 2 or 3% for, I would say, 30 years. But surprisingly enough, a lot of young fellows chew today that aren't in the kind of businesses you would expect, lawyers, doctors. There are enough young people coming in that it has prolonged chewing tobacco to the point where I think it'll be around forever.
Downstairs in Mr. Block's factory, where we expected we might find a few old men filling packages by hand, we found instead high-speed conveyor belts and the din of automation.
Has a little can in it that nobody knows about but she and her boss.
So it turns turns out the world is full of overt chewers and secret chewers, plug and scrap and twist chewers. They're all around us. And as we went on our way, those barns on the hillside didn't appear so old-fashioned anymore. And when we stopped for lunch at the Wells Inn in Sistersville, West Virginia, and visited its Victorian front sitting room, something about that sitting room suddenly seemed right up to date. Charles Kuralt, CBS News, on the road in West Virginia.
In 1879, the Block Brothers founded their tobacco company at a time when Wheeling enjoyed a national reputation as a center for stogie manufacturing, boasting over 100 stogie makers in the city. To compete against the more well-established companies, the Block Brothers developed a new product, chewing tobacco, and called it Mail Pouch, after the way steamboats delivered the city's mail by throwing large pouches of letters from the boat deck to the wharf. Mail Pouch continues today, over 100 years later, in part because of the success of an innovative marketing campaign. The classic Mail Pouch tobacco signs adorning the barns across America's heartland have become more than creative advertising. They are now part of America's folklore, an evocative symbol of America's nostalgic past. This is the story of the craftsman who etched the Mail Pouch symbol into America's consciousness. Sign painter Harley Warrick. Retiring after almost 50 years of sign painting, Harley Warrick painted a special mail pouch sign for the Wheeling Artisan Center in October of 1996.
One line at a time. I consider it a craft. It's more like a carpenter or a plumber or a pipe fitter or whatever. You do the same thing over and over. When I first started, we had four crews. There was eight guys all together. And then as years went by, they kept dropping off and dropping off. And then finally got down to I was the only guy left. And I did it myself for the last 20 years. Better than 20,000, counting new ones and repaints. I didn't even know how many I did, and then I did a film for Charles Kuralt, and he came down, where they counted them up down at the company. Hell, I didn't know I'd done that many. We had a dairy farm, and we had a mail pouch sign on our barn. And then I went through high school and then went to service and over in Germany during the war. And I'd only been home a couple of days and just so happened the crew come through to repaint the barn and I was over talking to them and that's where I got started. That was better than milking 27 head of Jerseys every night and morning. I didn't mind the farm, but I just thought this would be better, so. I leased the end of the barn off the farmer and paid him, you know, right there before he even painted it. Most of them didn't want anything, but the main thing was they couldn't care less about the tobacco. It was a landmark. It was, if you had somebody who was coming out of state to visit you, you said, well, you get down there to that mail pouch, and that's where we live. That's what most of them were. Of course, for the company, it was advertising. We had 20 states that we kept covered, you know. We covered it every 3 or 4 years, we'd go back and repaint them, mostly in the Midwest. Our biggest customers were steel workers or coal miners. So that's where you'll find most of the signs. Every day was an adventure. Whatever you thought couldn't happen would. I'll never forget that first contractor I went to work for, you know, and had a helper come out. And he was always worried about details, you know. And he says, we're up there on the side of the barn. He was talking about insurance, you know. He says, now, in case we fall off of that barn, what do we do, you know, insurance-wise? And the old contractor says, just paint like hell all the way down. Don't stop. I remember one time I was working in some little town up here towards Toronto or someplace. Big, all that wall was probably 70 feet high. And no place to fasten the ropes on. So here's this guy coming down the street, and I said, would you mind holding these ropes while I go up and tie it off? No, I'll hold them. I said, be sure you stand on them now. Don't let loose of them. I went up there and tied it off, and then some guy was standing down there just on edge, you know.
Uh-huh.
He said, you would. You picked the biggest drunk in town. He says, that guy salute. He don't know where he's at. Here I had him holding them ropes.
Oh, God.
Yeah. It didn't matter if the painter got wet, as long as the sign didn't get wet. Yeah, I had a Greek kid work with me. He was from up here at Warwood. He wouldn't say three words all day. We're working away there, and all at once, this roof comes off the barn, comes right up over the top of our head and out the field, you know. He said, well, I believe it's about time to quit. That's like my first wife. She told me, you know, either change jobs or change wives. And I said, I'm glad you brought that up, because wives are easier to find than jobs. What do you know? It fits in there. You're surprised how many times I run out of space, too. Once in a while, you do it intentionally. You had a barn that set on a kind of an angle of the road, you know.
You'd
run it right around the corner. Then put an oops back of it. We had one guy, though, he was there for years. And he would reverse the letters and treat yourself to the best. He'd have an S-L-E-F. He'd do that every once in a while. When we had crews working out there, though, if we'd screw one up, we'd put the other guy's name on it. But just for the heck of it, every once in a while, I'll put three C's in tobacco just to get somebody to pay attention to it. And sure enough, they'll write into the company and say that sign painter must have been drunk or something. He's got three C's in there. So they send him a letter, you know, thanking them for paying attention to the sign. Well, Good Morning America, they bugged me for about 2 years. They wanted me to come up to New York and do the program, you know. And I said, hell, there's no barns in New York City. And they said, well, we'll fake it. And I said, nope, we won't fake it. I said, we got plenty of barns out here. So it went on for about 2 years. And finally, they decided to come down to little town of Barnesville and do it. So, yeah, you got to know some pretty good people out there. That's the only part of the job I actually miss anymore, is visiting with the farmers, or the owners.
Yeah.
They weren't all farmers. You got to know the whole family, you know. Well, then you'd come back again in about 2 or 3 years and revisit. It's just like going home, you know. I remember I did a television thing one night, and they was asking me a question there about what young people ought to do for a job, you know. And I said, well, do what you would do for as a hobby, you know, and get some darn fool to pay you for doing it. Well, Stuart, he happened to be listening to it, you know, and he called me. He says, yeah, he says, this is that darn fool that's paying you. Mail Pouch was a good outfit to work for.
following up on a story they covered years ago. Recently, Jenny Krim and photographer Gary Burnett traveled to southern Ohio to spotlight this one-of-a-kind painter who's left a lasting impression on America.
Boy, Jen, I can't believe it's been 10 years since we've been down here.
And now, a decade later, we're back in Belmont, Ohio to show you a one-of-a-kind artist.
Boy, this guy is fantastic, too.
Yeah, many call him the Rembrandt of rural America.
And although you might not recognize his name, you've probably seen his claim to fame, mail pouch plugs painted on barns. For 45 years, Harley Warrick traveled millions of miles canvassing the countryside, leaving his lasting legacy on over 20,000 barns. And even though he started out earning only $32 a week, he loved being his own boss in the wide open spaces.
It was just like being retired all my life. I would have done for nothing. I'd do it all over again if I could.
Harley Ernest Warrick has literally left his mark on the American landscape because every single barn bears his initials, H-E-W.
To me, it's a challenge. You drive up here to this old rough raw barn, you know, and then when you leave there, there's something there. You created something. And if you kick the bucket tomorrow, somebody's going to know you've been there.
Was it dangerous, you know, climbing up there and dangling on those ladders?
No more dangerous than driving to the job. That was the most dangerous part, but at least, you know, you knew what your equipment could stand, and there was a calculated risk. You'd take a spell once in a while, but get your attention. Out on that interstate, you got to watch the other nuts. On the barn, there's only one nut up there. So.
3 years ago, Harley stepped down and retired as the country's last barn painter. And as a farewell gift, the company gave him, what else? A lifetime supply of mail pouch.
I don't know whether they must have thought I wasn't going to live too long or something. So.
In fact, Harley's working harder than ever now, making and marketing mail pouch memorabilia in the form of mailboxes, birdhouses, and feeders. And why do so many folks flock to his farm to purchase a piece of the past?
It reminds them of the older days. They don't seem to like where the country's going, so they want to kind of see what it was like, you know, before. It's part of American history, I guess.
Harley, who's also a part of American history, tells us how he keeps so active and vital at age 72.
Keep busy. Don't have any spare time. Spare time gets you in trouble.
And Harley's kept out of trouble and has enjoyed a lifetime of success by never biting off more than he can chew. From Belmont, Ohio, this is Jenny Krim.
And if you have a one-of-a-kind story, write to Jenny Krim at 3001 Euclid Avenue, Cleveland, Ohio, 44115.
I'm not sure there's anybody who's ever driven in the country who hasn't seen at least one of those barns. I'm glad he's keeping them alive.
Chances are you've never heard of Harley Warrick. But if ever you've traveled a country road or wandered the back highways of this country, you've seen his work. It was these hands that painted this simple message on the sides of so many barns. It all started one day back in 1946, when he watched mail pouch workers touch up his father's barn.
I went on talking to the crew, and they said, well, we need a guy on another crew, so if you want a job, come on. So I went over and took my duffel bag, and away I went.
For generations since, the Mail Pouch Tobacco Company used these barns for advertisement, but they subtly became much more than that. They became a part of the character of our countryside and an image generations will never forget. And for the last 20 years, Harley Warrick was the only man left in this country who painted them.
At one time, see, everybody advertised on barns and buildings because there wasn't any billboards. So mail pouch, they just, instead of switching over to billboards, they just stayed on the barns.
But somewhere along the way, something changed. We began to build super highways that coldly took us from one place to another and away from those back roads. As life went by at 55 miles per hour, these barns began to fade. Then the only man who still painted them got cancer, and the end of an era had begun.
The biggest change is you have an old barn someplace, and you think, well, about 5 years I'll go back and redo it. And when you come back, there's a shopping mall sitting there.
Harley was forced to hang up his brush 2 years ago, and on the road, the impressions of his work are beginning to fade. Words and letters that were once bold lemon yellow are bleached white now with the sun. Some barns are so faded you have to trace the letters with your eyes. These old familiar friends of the road are quietly fading now into the wood. About the only barns Harley Warrick paints these days are the miniature barns he builds, or the ones he paints on canvas. He simply can't keep up with the barns on the road, but he wants to keep his hand in the work that has provided him a living all these years.
I always told my children, you really want to know what to do for a living. I said, well, pick you a job you would do for nothing, get some darn fool to pay you for doing it.
During his 45 years painting these barns on the road, he has made a lot of friends and drawn his share of attention. Harley and his work have been on postcards and calendars. He's met politicians and television celebrities.
Oh, Charles Kuralt, Ted Koppel. I did barn for him. And a few governors and representatives and whatever.
You don't sound too impressed with the politicians.
No, they're not my favorite people.
His favorite people, he says, were the farmers. And this simple sign on the side of a barn is what brought them together. It's hard, Harley says, knowing he's the last artist of an era that is fading fast. But as long as there is a ghost of an image on the side of a barn, it will always be a reminder of Harley Warrick.
At least when I'm gone, at least I'll have a lot of tombstones out there to show I've been there. So. Because there's a part of you in every one of those barns anyway.
Hello, and welcome to Capital Edition. I'm John Goldsmith, and let me tell you something. This sure beats a stuffy old television studio by a country mile. In fact, in our case, by quite a few country miles. We have forsaken our usual electronic environment and the big city around it to come out here where the state bird is not a construction crane, and where you can hear its song, where it isn't drowned out by the sound of jackhammers, police sirens, and rush hour traffic. From this particular location, you can actually see three states. That's Virginia, that's Maryland, we're standing in West Virginia. Some say this is God's country. Well, we don't know about that, but we're going to spend the next hour telling some stories here. We think it's not all heaven, but it sure is different. There's a fellow we know who drives the roads in these parts, looking for just the right farm, just the right barn. The farm to him is kind of an artist's studio, and the barn is a blank canvas. Jan Thompson caught up with him in Frostburg, Maryland.
Yeah, I was born and raised on a farm. Used to be out in the country, so that's my favorite spot. So, yeah, you're out in the weather. Sometimes it's not so good, but then at least you're out in the fresh air and sunshine.
Fresh air and sunshine, and symbols of life beyond suburbia. Grazing cattle, old wagon wheels, fields of Queen Anne's lace. And we mustn't forget the billboard of the back roads of mid-America, the mail pouch barn. Meet Harley Warrick. He paints the mail pouch signs. In fact, over the years, he has had a hand in painting almost every one of them. He's a study in nostalgia, as much a part of rural Americana as the barns he paints and loves.
Well, I hate to see a nice old barn go to pot. They'll let the roof get off of it, and then it's only about a couple of years it's going. And no one could afford to put those back up the way they were. It's what strains me is, I guess it's American system, but people will tear down a real old building, make a parking lot out of the area. Then they'll take the money that they got out of the building and get on a jet and fly to Athens or Greece to see an old building. When they had some right here, they didn't preserve them. Now everybody puts up metal buildings. And I just won't paint one on a metal building. It doesn't look right. It's got to be a poor, old, distressed looking barn, sagged down the middle. So people feel sorry for the thing. I think that's the reason they like them so well.
Harley knows his barns as well as anyone. He figures he's painted more than 18,000 of them since joining Mail Pouch right after World War II. Back then, there were several barn painting crews on the road. These days, Harley is the crew, the last of a kind.
It used to be quite a crew. There used to be eight of us, so. And you had some pretty good times. You'd go out and work all day, and then just about like a bunch of cowboys, we'd come into a certain town on a weekend, have our paycheck, and just about like somebody coming in the Long Branch Saloon, the whole bunch would get together, and so we had quite a picnic.
20 years ago, the picnic was rained out by the Highway Beautification Act, which banned a lot of roadside advertising. Harley kept busy painting barns off the beaten track until the lawmakers finally acknowledged a flaw in their vision of beauty. They designated the existing Mail Pouch barns historic landmarks, reminders of a different time, a different way of life. Now, most of Harley's time is spent reliving the past, repainting the old barns.
I'm doing a job exactly the same as I did 30-some years ago, and using the same equipment and whatever, so I might say I'm working in the past, so. Yet it's crazy to me, but it got real popular there all at once, so. Puts me in mind of a guy out here in the field someplace digging a ditch, and then all at once somebody says, well, look, there's a guy digging a ditch, and then it gets real popular. Yeah, it's enough to make it. Somebody told me 20 years ago somebody would be taking a picture of you pouring lamp black into a bucket and stirring it up. I'd said, you're crazy.
Crazy as it may seem, Harley has become somewhat of a national treasure. In him, we can celebrate an old-fashioned ethic, the hardworking individual who takes pride in what he does and does it well.
So how do you feel about all the publicity that you get?
Oh, you appreciate it, but I mean, it doesn't make the barn any easier to paint, and the sun's just as hot and the rain falls just the same. It doesn't make any difference as far as the work.
Why is it you think people are so curious about you?
Well, just like the last of anything, I guess. It's the old American system. When something becomes scarce, they gotta have it.
And people have had it in some of the strangest places. He's painted the Mail Pouch sign on the bottom of a swimming pool, on the side of an elephant, and where advertising is normally forbidden, in the middle of a state park in Ohio.
I wonder, it didn't even seem like that's a legal thing to do, is to advertise in a state park.
This is more or less just an antique barn. Mm-hmm. And they show antiques and then show the kids that stay here how old barns were built and this, that, and the other. Our standard color is black and black background, but in this case the barn was already red, and it was kept in pretty good shape, so I just put a red background.
Did you get a lot of attention while you were painting this barn since it's in a state park?
Yeah, well, of course, when I was painting it, I was doing a commercial for television, so there was quite a few people here.
I've painted about 17,000 of these Mail Pouch barns in my time.
It's not surprising that the Madison Avenue types chose this country character to star in the barn painter commercial. After all, Harley's been playing Harley all his life. Who could do it any better?
Why am I still painting? Well, I guess I'm a little like the Mail Pouch folks. When you got a good thing, you stick with it.
So do you really think that by you painting Mail Pouch on the sides of barns, that helps to sell the product?
Well, it keeps the name there in front of the public. And I don't know of any other company in the United States that people will pay themselves to have that sign put on their barn, and I do quite a few of those.
Harley Warrick leaves his signature on more than 150 barns a year. And what does an old barn painter do when he's not painting barns? He paints miniature barns, sells them as bird feeders and mailboxes. Wherever you see mail pouch painted, chances are Harley did it.
Well, there's a lot of people who tell me I'm lucky, you know, but I've always figured that luck goes along with hard work. The harder you work, the luckier you get, usually. And if they had to go out and follow you around for a week, then I don't think they'd think you're quite that lucky.
But what kind of special gratification do you get out of doing the mail pouch barns?
Well, you pull up to an old beat-up barn there in the morning, and there's nothing there, and then you keep blasting away at her all day long. When you leave in the evening, you've left your trademark. At least you've showed somebody that you've been there, so it's kind of a mark, like Johnny Appleseed or whatever. You're going across the country, and at least you can say, I've been there.
Covering Belmont County tonight, if you've traveled any country road in the Buckeye State, you've probably seen his work. And today, a group called the Barnstormers celebrate the life and art of Belmont's own Harley Warrick. From about 1946 until his death in 2000, Harley Warrick painted and repainted nearly 20,000 mail pouch signs. Most of them you can find on the sides of barns. Warrick was employed by Mail Pouch and paid farmers $5 to $10 a year to use their barn as a billboard. Today, nearly every one of the Barnstormers we talk to say they started their fascination with Warrick in a snap by simply taking a picture of one barn. Those pictures turned into a hobby.
First, I thought I had a very unique hobby until I met other people who did the same thing by way of the internet, and now I found out that there are dozens of us, actually, which is really neat. So we had a common interest. We shared taking pictures of mail pouch barns, and some of us had met Harley Warrick, and we just wanted to get together and talk about him and mail pouch.
Club president Lonnie Schnoffer started taking pictures of the barns, and one day he called Warrick out of the blue.
It was a great visit. I enjoyed every minute of it. He had so many colorful stories to tell about his life. And I would go back, and a lot of times, some of these pictures I would take, I'd get 8x10 photos made, and then I'd take them out and ask Harley to sign them for me, and he would.
Warrick's son, Roger, went out to paint some of the barns with his dad. He says he can't believe the collection of memorabilia from his father's art.
It's pretty impressive. I thought I had a good collection, but, you know, I don't know where all these people find the time to go shoot these things, but, you know, I'm glad they do.
But there are a number of reasons people appreciate Warrick's work.
I think that people that grew up around here and in the Ohio Valley recognize Mail Pouch. It's a symbol of Americana, as it's been called. It's a reminiscent of that simpler time, you know, when people were happy and not so stressed about things. And I think it just makes a lot of us think about better times.
The group is planning some restoration projects to preserve Warrick's signs. If you'd like to know more about the group, you can log on to our website at WTOV9.com. We'll link you to their site. And welcome to our Labor Day special. I'm Jan Goldsmith.
And I'm John Goldsmith.
This installment is all about what makes America work, namely, those of us who work in America.
140 million stories seems a little much to squeeze into a one-hour show, and so we've whittled the list down to a more manageable number that we hope you find interesting. Here's a quick preview. A photographer not lost in the wilderness, building sandcastles in the sky, towing banners over the beach, laboring to pull America together. The country's oldest beer maker, a family working from sap to syrup, a daughter laboring in dad's shoes, remembering those barnyard billboards and some who sweat while we...
If you recognize the signs, it's a sign of how old you are. Firma Shave gave up roadside advertising back in 1964. But you may still be able to spot some of these barnyard billboards. But soon, they too will become just a memory. It has been one man's labor of love to capture this picture of vanishing America before it's too late.
I was here 7 years ago and took a picture, and the first thing that surprised me is how faded the sign is, how you can hardly see it. And the second thing is that there's a much more disrepair. I didn't realize how fast it's disintegrating. But the reason I started is just because of this. You know, they're not going to be around forever, and at least I have a visual record of these barns.
Tom Plimpton never intended to become a photo documentarian of mail pouch barns.
No, I was a banker, and I lived in Indianapolis, and my folks lived in Lake County near Chicago. And I passed a couple mail pouch barns on the way up, and I said, they're going to go the way of the Burma Shave signs. And so I took a picture of a couple of them, and that led to a couple more, and pretty soon an hour and a half drive up home was taking 3 and 4 hours as I was going, you know, and I just got hooked.
Since 1982, Plimpton estimates he's traveled 10,000 miles photographing 235 mail pouch barns. Half of those are already gone. Many more are rapidly deteriorating. Victims of changing times and a changing countryside.
This is the first picture. It's the one I passed all the time when I was going home to visit my folks. It's now down. This barn's also down. This is a barn on US 40, gone. This is a barn going from Bloomington to Brown County, gone.
While the barns are a study in nostalgia, so too is the man who had a hand in painting almost all of them.
There used to be quite a crew. There used to be 8 of us, so. And you had some pretty good times. You'd go out and work all day, and then just about like a bunch of cowboys, we'd come into a certain town on a weekend, and the whole bunch would get together, and so we had quite a picnic.
Harley Warrick was the last of the mail pouch barn painters. After nearly a half a century of leaving his signature artwork on some 20,000 barns, he retired to his Ohio home in the heart of what was mail pouch country.
Yeah, I've been driving along, and landscape just seems familiar, you know. There should be a barn here someplace, and here's a mall sitting there, or a bunch of new homes.
Back when he was still painting, Harley had already begun to sense that this part of rural Americana was slowly fading into history.
Well, I hate to see a nice old barn go to pot. They'll let the roof get off of it, and then it's only about a couple of years it's gone. And no one could afford to put those back up the way they were.
After the Highway Beautification Act banned many billboards in the 1960s, some mail pouch barns were saved by an historic designation, and Harley ended his career on the road, alone, repainting them.
And using the same equipment and whatever, so I might say I'm working in the past, so. Yet it's I don't know, it's crazy to me, but it got real popular there all at once. So. If somebody told me 20 years ago somebody would be taking a picture, I'd be pouring lamp black into a bucket and stirring it up, I'd say you're crazy.
By the time he was the subject of this television profile in the mid-80s, Harley had already become somewhat of a national treasure in whom we could celebrate the old-fashioned work ethic.
Well, there's a lot of people who tell me I'm lucky. You know, but I've always figured that luck goes along with hard work. The harder you work, the luckier you get, usually.
So how do you feel about all the publicity that you get?
Oh, you appreciate it, but I mean, it doesn't make the barn any easier to paint, and the sun's just as hot and the rain falls just the same. It doesn't make any difference as far as the work.
Why is it you think people are so curious about you?
Well, just like the last of anything, I guess. It's the old American system. When something becomes scarce, they gotta have it.
No one knows exactly how many mail pouch barns remain, but Harley figures all of them will weather away within a decade. The last mail pouch painter now leaves his signature on small replicas of the barns he loved.
I'd say 99% of the people that buy this off of me has nothing to do with tobacco. They don't smoke, they don't chew. It's just a landmark thing. They grew up with it.
Harley is working on a book about his barns. Tom Plimpton plans to donate his photos to an historical society so that we might remember these colorful pieces of vanishing America.
I was going to say sad, but it's really not sad because I knew from the beginning this is what was going to happen to the barns. But once you get hooked, they kind of become your friends. Probably wistful is a good way to say that. Maybe a little sad, but wistful, just that it's something that you can't bring back in nostalgic Americana.
I'm not a celebrity, I just paint barns, that's all.
Harley Warrick might not see himself as someone special, but to many, he's a folk hero of sorts. As the only person in the country who paints mail pouch ads on barn sides, his work's become a collector's item. He's painted over 18,000 of them in 40 years, never realizing he'd receive such national notoriety. Each time he paints, he starts from scratch, so no two signs are the same.
It's just freehand. You just look at the end of the barn and when you're driving up to it, and you can tell just about where everything goes, and all you do is make a top and bottom line.
Isn't that kind of tough?
It is for the first 10,000 signs, and after that, it gets a little bit easier.
There's a lot to be said about being your own boss and blending into the beauty of Mother Nature.
To me, it's the greatest job in the world. But you're out, and you get to meet so many interesting people. You're always pretty close to nature when you're out there. You're out working outside. I cannot stand to work inside. The walls start squeezing in on me.
Rumor had it that Harley might hang up his brushes and retire. Does he plan to quit?
No. Not as long as my health holds up, as long as the good Lord keeps me going. The way I look at it, every sign I do, it might be my last one, but I don't intend it to be that way.
In his spare time, Harley dabbles in oil paintings and builds birdhouses of, you guessed it, barns plugging mail pouch. Even though barn painting's a dying art, the whole countryside's been his canvas, and Harley's excited to think that future generations will see his signature long after he's gone.
At least you're leaving something behind. It's something you did. And no matter whether you leave any money or not, you've left a little heritage behind you.
Perhaps Harley's greatest personal reward comes from the fact that he's left his mark almost everywhere in America. From Belmont, Ohio, Jenny Krim, Eyewitness News. If you've traveled through rural America, no doubt you've seen signs on the sides of barns advertising mail pouch tobacco. Ever wonder who put them there? Well, meet the man with a pipe dream that came true. 60-year-old Harley Ernest Warrick has been canvassing the countryside for nearly 40 years, painting the mail pouch message, each bearing his initials.
In the word chew, my initials are in it. The letters H-E-W, that is my initials, so I've got my initials on every barn there is.
Even though Harley never had any formal art education, he quickly climbed the ladder of success, where he stayed ever since. To him, the best part of the job is being his own boss in the wide open spaces. Farm animals graze and gaze as Harley transforms the barn into a work of art. But what about the dangers of dangling from ladders?
I don't mind the height. The most dangerous part of the job is driving to and from work out on the highway. There's all kinds of nuts on the highway, and there's only one up there on the side of the barn. So.
As the only person still painting mail pouch plugs, he's left a lasting impression on America.
To me, it's a challenge. You drive up here to this old, rough, raw barn, you know, and then when you you leave there, there's something there. You've created something. And if you kick the bucket tomorrow, you know, somebody's going to know you've been there.
Harley guesses he's painted over 18,000 barns in his lifetime. And his secret to success? Well, he's never bitten off more than he can chew. Jenny Krim in Belmont, Ohio for Eyewitness News.
Charlie Warrick died Friday at the age of 76. Friends came to the United Methodist Church to honor the World War II veteran. But Warrick will be remembered most for the thousands of barns across the United States that he painted with the mail pouch advertisement.
He believed in a full day work. He had a job to do, and he was going to do the job, a good job, at a good pace. By 1991, he had painted over 20,000 barns.
In October, Warrick painted the mail pouch sign for the last time. He repainted this barn on the grounds of Bark Camp State Park. Mail pouch barns are now maintained as national landmarks. However, new signs can't be painted because of bans on tobacco advertising.
I am Harley Warrick, but you certainly know his artwork. Take a look. The 76-year-old painter who decorated mail pouch tobacco barns across the country died this weekend. Harley's last barn was here at Bark Camp State Park, which you see right here. A memorial service is scheduled for Tuesday in Warrick's hometown of Belmont, Ohio.